dining room in one half of High Chimneys was, like the rest of the property, in need of refurbishment when Elizabeth and I purchased the house in 1969. At that time, the old house was divided to make two dwellings, and we bought the half which included a later extension. The old house was built in 1661, and according to some scratched bricks, the extension added in about 1906. The dining room that was in the extension had windows at both ends. Earlier, the room had been described as a coach house, and later a garage with folding steel doors. There was clear evidence of the fixings that held the trackway when the metal doors were opened and folded back into the room. The doors were removed in the 1960s and replaced by a bow window. But the window had problems. It was hastily built, the window leaked, and it did little to prevent the cold from entering into the room, and was not in keeping with the style of the house. We decided that the bow window simply had to go. It didn't take much effort to remove the roof, which allowed the window to be taken out, leaving a gaping hole, and the bricks offered little resistance to a Kango hammer. Timber salvaged from some demolished sheds were used to make a new window, and the Kango hammer used to remove the concrete floor to be replaced by a timber floor using boards from the demolished buildings. With that end of the room complete, it was time to work on the other end, where we planned to replace the windows with double doors leading into a conservatory and on into the garden. We had no money to pay for builders, so had to tackle the work ourselves. Removing the windows and brickwork was a bit tricky, and we used a number of acro props to take the weight to prevent the wall above from collapsing while the opening was created. This allowed a girder to be inserted and new bricks added to take the weight so that the props could be removed. Next, a set of double doors was made to fit the opening, and the work could start on the conservatory. Once the foundations had been dug to the depth required by the building inspector, bricks for the wall to support the timber frame could be laid. Willing friends were called upon to help position another girder, which would take the weight of the conservatory roof. Elizabeth was busy surrounding the area with flower beds even before the roof was finished, but a few weeks later it was glazed and painted and ready for use. But that wasn't the end of the story. Because of the shortage of funds, I had made the mistake of using old timber when replacing the bow window. It suffered badly in cold winters and in wet summers. Elizabeth had planted flowers which, when wet, flopped onto the window, causing the wood to rot. By 2015, it was beginning to disintegrate and had to be replaced. For the new window, it seemed sensible to follow the design of the original windows so that it would blend in with the house. Some West African red sapel hardwood was purchased, cut to size and laid out on the garage floor. The wood was very heavy and a completed window would be difficult to move, so I decided to make it in kit form, allowing the pieces to be moved separately and the window assembled using coach bolts when in position. When the new window was ready, Phil, my great nephew-in-law, came to help. It was impossible to remove the glass panels, so he decided to attack them like a determined burglar. Within a couple of hours, the glass had been smashed and the frame removed, leaving the area clear for the new window to be assembled. After the pieces had been bolted together, my neighbour Kevin and his friend came to help her to lift it into place. Fortunately, it fitted, and wedges were hammered in to hold it secure. New double glazing panels were soon in position, and a few coats of varnish brought the window to life, and the old coach house can once again serve as a dining room.